Kadas dan manamis Jesus param Jesus torus mangagit talo pa ug minagungan para ta kontinuay ni kung ang publiko i pudi manera ni Bill 426-31 COR. We just din punuponi ini ni gobyerno para u night sa lante otro sakan ni taman no ta gasta i sa lapi i publiko ni man papasigi tax the tau usa para ta na isya isidbisyo. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the reconvening of this public hearing on Bill 426-31 COR, the proposed FY 2013 budget request by the Governor of Guam. This is the legislation that will provide for us the roadmap for the expenditures of the public resources that we collect in taxes and in turn provide them public services by the departments and agencies of the Government of Guam. Once again, I want to thank all of you for joining us this morning and being present here. And I want to begin by again introducing my colleagues who are here with us this morning. To my right is, of course, Senator Aileen Yamashita. Good morning, Senator Sam Abini, Senator Mona Silva Tarun, and Senator Frank Blas Jr. Thank you very much, my colleagues, for your presence here this morning. And again, we have the representative of the administration that will present this request. Yesterday, we looked at the revenue numbers, both for this fiscal year and where we hope to end the fiscal year, and the revenue numbers for next fiscal year that will provide this resources as allocated in Bill 426. This morning, we will begin looking at the current year expenditures and the projected expenditures for the next fiscal year and provide us an opportunity to take a look at the allocation of these resources based upon the priorities set by the administration as submitted in Bill 426. So we'd like to thank the administration's representative here this morning. And would recognize Mr. Rios, the director of BBMR, and his financial management team that's here with him this morning, and give him the mic to begin the presentation. So, Mr. Rios, buenas tardes, Jesus.
Good morning, Mr. Chair.
Again, I'm going to interrupt you like yesterday so that I can introduce my other colleagues and just throw your timing off a little. My other colleagues who are here with me this morning, to my right is Speaker Judy Wompat, also chair of the Department of the Committee on Education, and to her right is Senator Tony Adams. Welcome, and Sidus Masi. Mr. Rios.
Good morning, Senator, again, and members of the committee. I'd like to go ahead and first go ahead and provide a copy of our comparison.
Yes.
That we provided for 12 and 13.
Okay.
We did receive the template last night.
Okay.
And for the committee, we are working in inputting the numbers on your format.
Uh-huh.
And we should be able to provide that for you next week sometime.
Okay.
Okay. And that's with the detailed expenditures, salary.
Like object class.
There may be an issue because you've requested for a 10-2, and the end of July hasn't closed yet.
Okay.
Okay. And so we may have a 7.5, 4.5, or sometime I think middle of June, right? Is it the middle of June? That's the information that we have
okay.
right now.
That's
okay.
Fine.
So we'll indicate it there so you guys will know.
Right.
Okay, so I'm not sure if you have the comparison.
Hold on.
Okay. So what I'll do is I'll go ahead and just discuss the overall, and then when you want to go into detail in which agency, then you can go ahead and get into detail with that. So first of all, with the executive direction, On the general fund itself, and that includes, of course, the Bureau Commission, the Condemnation Election Commission, and it's listed there. There was a minus 2.62% decrease when compared to the 2012 appropriation. On the overall, including the special funds and the federal match, there was a minus 2.42 decrease on the appropriation level, and that's for the executive direction. For the public safety, which includes police, fire, corrections, youth affairs, chief medical examiner.
I'm going to allow the panel here.
Okay.
As you go through the different functional areas, or then, and they see a question, I'm going to ask them to go ahead and, as we go through that, ask their question. And for one thing, for me, on the Guam Election Commission, the decrease of $254,000 with an election this year, within this fiscal year of the primary election, is that was that at the request of the commission, or was that as a result of an adjustment and discussion with the Bureau of Budget and Management?
My name is John Pangolinan, Supervisor of BBMR. Basically, for 2012, we did a projection for the Guam Election Commission, and to include the reserves, we found that there were, as of June, there were a lapse in $150,000 in lapse funding. When we did the election, when we did the budget, we also looked at what they spent. And basically, because of limited resources, we reduced the Guam Elections funding for 2013, based on the fact that they were lapsing, I believe, in the prior year and for this fiscal year.
Well, but I understand that, but didn't we just use a portion of that lapse, I guess,
yes,
to
did.
Pay that prior year obligation?
Yes.
Which would then remove that resources or expend that resource, but was there a budget for the primary election?
We still have in their reserves over $100,000 in funding that's available for this fiscal year. So we believe that it should be sufficient enough to cover, plus their lapses, to cover the election for this year, for the primary.
Okay.
Sorry, Speaker, Ben's following up on that, but I read that they still have past due obligations.
We paid $74,000 using the prior obligation under Section 1 of the missing provision, and that was the only one that they gave us.
So and as far as you know, all their past due obligations are paid?
Based on the $74,000 that they gave us. That's all they gave us.
Yeah.
It based on what they submitted.
Speaker Wampak.
Thank you. I think the reason why you're seeing that lapse there was the additional funding that was provided for the registration.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, you know, that entails a little bit more in, you know, in terms of the resources that they need to get the individuals to go out and register, and also in the planning, of course, of getting, you know, the word out, and they have not started to really do that.
Well, we did give the One Election Commission opportunity to resubmit a budget based on data from AS400. They've yet to do so. We did provide them that opportunity. In fact, I had Maria Pangolinan and one of her assistants. I showed her how to do the projection, and I said, this is basically what we do, very simple, and then provide the reasons or needs for the additional requirement. I've yet to receive that.
And I know, and I concur with the previous speaker, Senator Yamashita, who said that there are other outstanding obligations that we have also have received word on, and, you know, and we would definitely do a follow-up as well then, because I don't think they are in that position at all, really, to say that, you know, they are, you know, that they have more money than they really need, and especially, of course, this year. It always occurs only in the election year, and the election wouldn't be able to continue without us having to pay our debts through these vendors, you know, for the machines and programs that we use.
We did offer the doctor to have her give us what she needed for the election, and I did ask her to do a projection that we all can agree on based on the S-400 data. Again, we're still waiting for that.
So if we're able to get, you know, the numbers, of course, from them, you would be willing then to make the adjustments?
Senator, hi, good morning. My name is Steve Guerrero. Under the miscellaneous appropriation, we've actually allocated about $100,000 for the upcoming election.
Okay,
so it's not that what you're saying here is the only funding for the election commission, but also it does not include the $100,000 under the miscellaneous appropriation.
Okay. Yes, Senator Adam.
Thank you. You know, according to the media, the GEC still owed $200,000 for legal services from the last election.
We did ask Maria Pangolin what her prior application was. It was required, and she said that was dealing with the that vendor that provided electrical services, and mesothelioma was brought up on the request. So whatever she submitted is what we acted on.
Speaker had mentioned that part of the reason why maybe they're lapsing somewhat is that there was a miscellaneous appropriation for their purpose for the decolonization registry, and so they haven't kicked off that program, and so maybe that's why they're lapsing down. Or are you only looking at what they're lapsing only on their operation and not?
We're looking at the base operations.
The base operations.
Okay.
And so. It's kind of, even at that, the ballot printing, the public auditor, or the most recent estimate, I guess, that people were throwing out, it cost about $1 a ballot. And so to print the ballot, only the ballot, for the primary election, we could be talking about $100,000 because of all the races. You're talking about printing three separate sheets of paper, possibly, maybe two, minimum, maybe three. So if it's $50,000, you know, for one office, so for one paper, for one ballot, so if you're printing two ballots, you're talking about, you know, $100,000. So there's the $100,000 in the miscellaneous appropriation. But you still now have your precinct officials, and the precinct officials, I think that may be even more than $100,000. So I think we'll certainly advise the Election Commission the Bureau remain based upon the conversations they've had, and I want to get a reiteration from them that all the discussions that were conducted with the Bureau took into account all these factors. So.
What I would like also to know that all they have to do is give us a listing what they need in terms
sure.
of based on the latest projection.
Sure.
So that we can look at and see in terms of, they did provide information, but I really don't know where the data came from.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm looking at using the AS-400 as a Bible for
sure.
our projections. If they can justify it based on their needs and if they can itemize it, I'm sure the Bureau would be
okay.
willing to work with her to do whatever is necessary to get the election out.
All right. Well, we'll certainly advise the Election Commission of that offer. Yes, Senator Walker.
And I'm glad that you're going to be able to do that. But then the other, of course, is the separate appropriation for the registry. And I bring that up because the governor chairs the commission, the Committee on Decolonization, and the main area that we are on a standhold right now is the funding, of course, for not just registering, the Chamorros to vote, but then monies as well to use for the education of, the three different political status. And with those monies that are currently in the budget for the Election Commission to do just that, then that if there are the additional monies available, that it can definitely go towards the education portion, of not just the registry, but even the three political statuses. So it's important that continue to remain there. And I know that that the governor is, searching, of course, to be able to fund this.
But if you're looking for operational access to fund the registry, it may not be that easy, because I believe the governor's authority for reprogramming is only limited to the base operations. So any lapses available would just stay unless that is amended.
Well, but then, so are you saying then that with the amount of money that's there currently for the registry, that you're not making any recommendation, or it's not going to be reflected in the new fiscal budget, the removal of that, the removal of the registry and the money, of course, to support that?
The budget process is really dictated by the Chamorro Election Commission. We just provide the appropriate funding that's available through the ceiling process, and they decide as to what they want to do with the funding they have. The appropriation for the registry, that's usually, it is possible you should give them the same amount every year, but if the ceiling is not there or lower, then it's reduced accordingly.
What ceiling? The ceiling for the Election Commission office, or the ceiling for the registry?
When we do the ceilings for the department, for all the government-wide departments, it's based on the revenues that are expected to be received for the year. And it's appropriate accordingly based on the funding levels and based on the department's portion, prorated portion of the revenues, and whatever other items that has been that's the instruments were needed during the period of time. We wish we could give out a whole much to the other departments, but it's all dependent on the revenues that we're expecting.
Nobody's going to argue with you, of course, that, we wish we had more so that we can appropriate more, but I know that there are some priorities that have been set, and as, the governor is the chairperson, of course, of the commission, has made that, priority, and has been calling meetings now every month, and has instructed, his executive director and legal counsel actually to search, to be able to fund this. So I think just want to keep that.
And then, John, you might want to check on the appropriation for the registry, because that may not have had a continuing appropriation language in there. As a matter of fact, I don't think it did. So it means that if that lapsed, then it's not available for expenditure in the next fiscal year. Just for clarification purposes also, in the column, John, here for FY, Ms. Arias, for FY 2012, the appropriate authorizations, that's inclusive of all funds, right? Whereas in the 13, you broke it down into general fund, special fund, federal match?
Also for 2012, it's been broken down.
Oh, okay.
Each column, so.
On
the top side, the general fund, special fund, and federal.
It's broken down between the...
Yeah, okay. Every fund source is broken down.
So for... Okay, I got it. I see it now. Okay. All right. We can continue, sir. Oh, I'm sorry. Any other questions? Okay.
next category, public safety, which includes the police department, fire department, correction, youth affairs. We are requesting for a 9.98% increase in the general fund. The overall grant total, including special funds and federal fund, we're looking at a total of about 8.05% increase for fiscal year 2013.
John, a 31% increase in the general fund funding for corrections. Corrections. What would you attribute that to?
That was the meals, and which was not. In fact, I think in. That was for like the meals that were not included last year. Mm-hmm. Meals for the prisoners and.
And how did you cover that this year?
That was through the transfers. Within the general fund.
Within the general fund.
And also a portion of that was funded through the Compact Impact for 2012.
Okay. Now, the reimburse or the payment of the prisoners, there was an outstanding obligation, I guess, that we are on a payment schedule. Was that, is that all paid up? That should have been paid up, right? One more payment?
Bill Tekken, there is a small appropriation this year.
In this year?
Yes.
Because that was included?
That's right.
Okay.
There is a balance that I think it would be paid up by this fiscal year.
Yeah. Any additional personnel in here in this $5 million or 31% increase?
Are we talking specifically for corrections or all public safety?
No, corrections.
I believe this is just all bodies plus vacant positions,
okay,
that are already existing in the current 2012 staff.
So they were vacant positions vacated during the 2012 cycle.
That's correct.
Okay.
So you're saying then this $5 million increase are not just meals, but they are to include to rather fund vacant positions for DOC.
No, not necessarily. What it is, Senator, is during the course of the fiscal year, when these positions were actually budgeted in the beginning of the fiscal year, they basically may become vacant over the course of the year. These positions are still being funded as we go into 2013.
For the replacement.
For the replacement. Okay. So they're not really new positions.
All right, but what I'm trying to figure out then is the $5 million increase that it's to... to feed the inmates only, because even if they were vacated somewhere in between, the funding is still there.
That's correct.
It just means the body may not be there, but the funding remains and continues to be there until they fill it, but it's not part of this $5 million increase. We're just trying to figure out where the increase is coming from.
The meals were only 3.7?
That's correct. And once
so
we do the
what's the other 1.5 million?
When we do the breakdown on your sheet, it will break down from the salaries to contractual to benefits and all that. So it will show when we use your format to break it down and
okay.
Provide you next week. So it'll give you more details. So I'm sure there may be other categories that have
okay.
increased.
All right. And so when BBMR gives us that, we'll make sure that we send that to all three senators. It'll be part of the committee report as well.
Just as a reminder, going into 2012, Senator, the Department of Correction was one of those departments that were severely underfunded. In personnel alone, I think we budgeted about 2.7 just to cover the warm bodies going into 2013. So that's where a portion of the $5 million. $5 million increase, at least half of it is represented, is to cover the warm bodies actually on board that weren't totally funded in 2012.
But that was a priority of the administration because we didn't reduce the DOC funding request.
Yes, I guess.
Because one of the questions we always ask the directors when they come up here is that, you know, based on the ceiling that was set by the executive branch, can they live within that ceiling? And almost, I can say almost 99% of them would say yes. So it's, you know, just sometimes we get it straight that it's not us that has reduced the budget. And we just want to kind of clarify, because when initially when you said meals, you know, then we're just wondering the increase. Of course, I realize the population has increased, hence, of course, the meals being increased, but it's not, it's for positions as well. So we understand that. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. Any Senator Manasova?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I did have a question. I'm looking at most of these public safety agencies do see an increase, but as far as the fire department, there's almost a 2% decrease in their budget for 2013. Where is that coming from?
I think you're reducing it because your flame fund, I think, is.
I believe also the federal fund match.
The federal fund match reduces. Right. And then the flame fund, they're just reducing it because they've reduced the revenue projection for the flame fund.
That's correct.
And decided not to cover that.
Yeah, over the last 2 years, I think the appropriation out of the flame fund was somewhere about $500,000-$600,000. Beginning to realize that that's not materializing, so hopefully we're trying to put it back into line with the actual collections, which we hope would probably be top about 100,000 this year. We're crossing our fingers, but even at the current tracking right now, it's way, way below the revenue tracking on the flame.
Was it ever determined, I mean, since we're on the subject, was it ever determined how much is actually in the flame fund?
Can you repeat your question again, Senator?
Have we ever determined the actual amount that's in the flame fund? There were some questions previously that how much was in there.
Yeah, year-to-date collection. Yeah, year-to-date collection in the flame fund right now, I think, is about $86,000. What's being appropriated in the budget is $600,000. And we only have about maybe 3 more months, maybe 4 more months, if not including June. To realize collecting another $500,000, which I think is very unlikely at this point.
Right. Yeah, and so, well, the new revenue that will be deposited in the FAME fund, new revenue source is the ambulance fees. So we're going to, did you make contact with the GFD and their vendor? Do they have any preliminary numbers on just billings?
Not yesterday.
Okay. Maybe we can just call the fire department right now. I mean, they're on computers, so they should, their vendor should be able to kick up just how much have been billed. We're not even collected because that's that's paid by Medicare, paid by the insurance companies. So there's a good likelihood that some of those billings will be paid. But if we could just get an idea. Yeah. But I think they're connected real time, so. Do we have to call the fire chief in Afghanistan, or is there one here? He's back? Okay. All right. So, I guess, we'll also get we'll get an idea whether or not the reduction in the budget based upon the reduction in the revenue is not going to cause a shortfall based upon current operating run rates, right? So we're pretty sure of that. Does this include the new cycle? That is, you know, we're working on bringing in that new cycle that had been selected, notified, and then was placed on hold because of a lack of funding. So does this cost or budget take into account if those people are brought on board either at the end of this fiscal year, which we're trying to achieve, or at the beginning of the new fiscal year?
It does include funding for 15.
For 15.
15 positions.
Okay, so that includes that funding. Okay. All right. I just wanted to...
Does that include also the EMDs? Or would that be a separate budget for Homeland Security? Would they be funded separately, or the emergency medical dispatchers, are they funded under GFP? Just
E911?
Mm-hmm. These are basically just fire recruits. Where they actually place them once they're into the department is incumbent upon the department itself. Mm-hmm. But the positions that one fire recruit for are firefighters, fire recruits. Now the E911 basically are civilian positions, I understand. They are not part of this, funding was not provided for those positions in 2013.
Okay. So if we get to the E911, there'll be, or is that lumped in? That's not lumped into the fire department budget. So that'll be a separate budget. So
as far as you know, I know that's kind of jumping ahead because we haven't gotten there yet. But as far as you know, would it be included, the hires for the three personnel for EMD?
We need to check on that, Senator. We can get back to you.
Thank you.
I don't want to say anything and not be able to.
That's fair.
Okay. Senator Yamashita.
Thank you very much, Speaker Ben. I guess this question is tagged onto the previous speaker. These numbers then were supported by the directors? I mean, I'm looking at GPD, right? Can I say that Chief Berdalio is satisfied with this amount and that he can run his unit safely and efficiently? Did the directors have a final say, or at least a review, and say, well, okay, you know, this is good? I know Speaker Wompat made a statement how every time we ask a director, directors say, well, you know, we'll make it work. But I'd like to know, did every director see this final number and say that this is fine?
I think with every request from, I guess, most of the departments, they also included their wish list, so a lot of it was over and above what was provided. They do understand that there was limited resources, and then to answer your question, yes, they have certified these budgets that were submitted.
Okay. Thank you very much. You may proceed, Ms. Reyes. On the Department of Youth Affairs, a 20% increase, and I want to just transition here into welcoming and recognizing Senator Chris Duenas, who kind of reminded me. The reduction in the special fund request, is there a reason why we decided to delete that funding from the special request, from the special fund? DYN? It's just a switch in funding?
Yes, Senator. All we did was just switch the special fund to back to the general fund portion. The fund of healthy future.
Right, right.
Yeah, that's all we did.
That's all you did on that.
Yeah.
again, I noted in the budget request in the write-up that the medication with the nursing program with the nurse was it, I want to say eliminated.
On the nursing appropriation, I believe it was like 2 years ago, and it was, they had a continuing provision.
Right.
So whatever balances lapses every year carried forward. So I'm not sure what the balance is to date,
mm-hmm.
but I believe we didn't include that.
And that's included in the $380,000 increase. You believe that they'll be able to continue that program of providing the medication administration of that through appropriately licensed personnel under this additional increase?
I'm not sure.
Okay. Yes.
Since you're not sure then, but of course that is a necessity, have they then created an MOU maybe with public health so that they'll be able to provide those services?
No, I haven't seen.
I think it's important that because when you're talking about, of course, medications, you know, like for example, in the schools, our nurses can't administer medication, but yet, you know, it can be provided, of course, outside like the hospital, of course, or the clinics. So I think because and the reason for that for DOE is only because they don't have a director, a nursing director, or a physician supervising the nurses. However, at public health, they all are. They have a director who supervises, you know, the nurses. So, and in some discussions that, you know, Senator Frank Wells and I had actually with public health and with the nurses of the schools and even with EMTs, that public health was saying that, you know, they used to be able to do this, is actually assign nurses as needed out to the schools because they are able to supervise them based on the needs of the school. And more importantly, is to be able to even administer medications if they need to. So I think that because that, you know, is available, that you may want to look into having that MOU with public health and DYA.
Sure.
And just to add, Madam Speaker, last year's Budget Appropriation Act did reduce the budget request by $183,000. And so this increase of $383,000 just pretty much brought it up to the same levels on our request, and then even more. And again, the details we'll show you.
Okay.
All right.
As we proceed forward, I just wanted to ask, I guess, a question that we covers the entire budget. Increments are not budgeted or budgeted in this fiscal year.
They're not budgeted.
So there's no increments budgeted. And
also the law enforcement pay.
So there's no additional. Okay. You can proceed then.
Okay. Under the next section is Homeland Security. We're looking at a request in total 15.72% increase from the 2012 appropriation.
And this is?
This is customs, yeah.
Customs.
Customs and quarantine.
Right. And the increase is for their new office space?
Personnel, I believe.
Part of that.
The only appropriation, I believe, in the 2013 is the $500,000 for office space, but that only covers a portion of the total requirement. The increase here basically is just more for operations.
For operations.
Yes.
Okay. Yes, Senator Bloss?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I see that under this category, that it's just for customs, yet there's nothing for the Homeland Security Office of Civil Defense.
That's because they're fully federally funded.
Are they?
They're 100% federally funded, civil defense, yes.
there's a couple of, when I was there, there were a couple of positions that were funded. No more? Okay.
Yeah, all the staff of civil defense.
But
100%.
Along those lines, I still have communication with Homeland Security in D.C. that actually manages the funds. Can we double check on that? Because I think they're starting to migrate into a cost share throughout the nation to include Guam. Okay, so you know me with regards to my affinity towards this area, and I just want to make sure that, please. Okay, Bill.
Sure.
I know that we were using a provision or out of Interior that basically provided territories waiver from certain amounts, cost share amounts, up to a certain, I think, $250,000, if I'm not right.
That's correct.
But there was also discussions as a result of the deficit reduction discussions that are going on nationwide, that they were looking at dropping some of those waivers and actually now having jurisdictions actually put in cash as part of the cost share. So we can have somebody here, office can work with Homeland Security and check on this, because I'm a little wary about this.
I know they're in the process of preparing their grant application. They haven't notified us that there's going to be a reduction in the federal funds or whether there's going to be a local match requirement.
Great. How much are we getting from Homeland Security now? For that operation,
it's been reduced every year.
Yeah, was it now about? I mean, was it less than $500,000 already?
No, I believe it's still more than $500,000. Have it on the FBI.
The other concern that I got here is that, because that's what raises an issue with me, is that while the grant continues to go down, the cost to operate, you know, that entity rises. And at some point, how much we're getting in grant monies is not sufficiently covering our operational costs.
Back to 2009, Homeland Security received about $1.8 million.
Mm-hmm.
In 2010, it dropped down to $530,000.
Mm-hmm.
In 2011, went up to $1.1.
Yeah, but if the $1.1, how much is that? Because I think they can only get the administrative cost of that, right? I mean, that's not a whole operation. That's part of grant.
This is a total grant amount. Yeah, right. And I'm sure they're limited to maybe 10, 15, 20% of the administrative costs. But in 2012, they haven't received anything.
That's my concern.
Right.
Yeah. You know, and come the end of October, you know, how are we going to pay to maintain that in the midst of a... Yeah. So I'm going to ask that we look at that, because, yeah, I know they're running on a continuing resolution over there, but there's no more money in that account.
Understood.
Okay.
Understood.
Thank you.
Questions on the public safety? Okay, so John, we want to move on then to health.
Okay, under health, our requests on the general fund shows a 7.92% increase. Total, grand total, including special funds and federal match, it's approximately 7.69% increase, or $8.6 million. This category includes, of course, Guam Memorial Hospital, public health, also DSID, mental health, and the residential treatment fund.
Just for your information, we did call GFD, and on the billing, they have billed approximately $100,000 since they started the billing process. And this accounts for, I guess, they understand that they can bill back bill 90 days from the services since they started providing the services. So since they started their billing program, they could go back 90 days and back bill the insurance companies and Medicare. And so that accounts for about $100,000 of back billing. So they've asked for Medicare certification to allow to bill Medicare, and they send in their application for that certification. They haven't heard yet. I think they sent it in February, and it hasn't. They haven't received a certification yet. It's pending, but they'll be also be able to back bill that based upon receiving the certification. So,
did they say they would expect those funds this fiscal year, or?
No, they didn't. They didn't say, but okay. But the back billing of $100,000. Has been sent, and so probably some would probably come in this fiscal year. I think a portion of that will. If they sent the bills out already, they're probably putting them net 30.
$100,000 is great, Senator, but it's not dollar for dollar.
No.
There's a a vendor percentage that they take.
Right, I think it's and 15 cents, no.
No, it's a lot higher than that, I believe. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and
30 to 35%.
And the other thing is that...
I want that job.
The other thing is that when you do the billings to Medicare and to private
vendors,
they're discounted, so if you're looking at... dollar for dollar, it's not going to happen.
Right.
Well, you're going to get anywhere from, like, the hospital, anywhere from 20 cents on the dollar to 50 cents on the dollar.
Okay. I'm sure that, if you know that, then you'll factor that into the projections, right?
That's
why
it's bad dollars.
Okay. Okay, got it. John, there was, one of the things that I see here, as you say, under health, that we have, for example, the MIP and, of course, the matching requirements for Medicaid under the public health funding. And one of the things, of course, that we were able to do in the past and public health was able to do is to use the MIP payments as the matching with the pharmaceutical fund, which then allowed us to access the federal funds. Now, my understanding is that's been discontinued. So what that has resulted in is a shortage in the Medicaid area for the matching funds, where we were able to credit any payments we made to the hospital under the pharmaceutical fund towards a match for either MIP or Medicaid. Actually, we limited it to Medicaid, I think, and made that change with upon consultation with the hospital. But I think this year you're not allowing that, or you've changed the policy on that.
No, Senator. Actually, matter of fact, just a couple of weeks ago, we've actually redid the same funding mechanism with the hospital. That we did last year in 2011. The appropriation for the hospital for their Medicaid appropriation, I think, is around $6 million. Mm-hmm. Of the $6 million, we use $4 million
right.
as the local match for Medicaid.
For Medicaid?
Yes.
So
we are continuing that practice this year.
You're continuing that because
yes.
Because my conversation with public health was that just, you just did that now and weren't doing it at the beginning of the fiscal year, or?
At the beginning of the fiscal year, it really wasn't required at that point.
Uh-huh.
It's only in the implementation and the utilization of the federal dollars that we had to come up with the local match.
Right.
So as we get closer to the end of the fiscal year, as the billings start to pile up, then we have to seek what options are available to come up with a local match. And the hospital was involved in the conversation when this all took place.
Okay, all right. Yes. So I just want to know, make sure that, you know, because we've been able to maximize the payments to the hospital to access the federal dollars. And when we had spoken earlier this year, I guess like you say, you didn't require that, so you were just, you know, doing the match based upon the local and not applying the credit, I guess, on the pharmaceutical fund. And now you're doing that again. So, okay, I just want to make sure of that because, you know, and I think also I want to know that public health is actually is even, I think, using the CHIP dollars to as a match as well. And so that has, they've been fairly good about doing that, which allows us to minimize the actual cash requirement of the local funds while still meeting the matching requirements for the Fed program, which saves us some money and gives us that. And so is there any discussion are you having? You know, we're getting that increase in the Medicaid, right, that we can access that amount. Is there any plans to or any allocation of any additional resources to access the additional money for the feds? Okay, so from that $59 million or so? Or under the Affordable Care Act, or a tandem to that for the territories on the additional Medicaid money. Okay. Senator Yamashita.
Thank you very much, Speaker Ben. As we talk about public health, social services, and as they're utilizing strategies smartly, right, I'm wondering, in talking or communicating with the director there, you know, under the SNAP program, right, or Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program, we now have 43,000 participants, and we've got six people working at Public Health Social Services overseeing the $9.5 million, and they're feeling very stressed and pulled apart. And so the director had just gotten a call saying that if they don't increase their rate payment, that we will be paying a fine of $300,000. And they need 14 more people to help them run effectively and efficiently. I'm wondering if you would be able to, you know, to work or to speak with that director. And I know, you know, you've already said that all the directors have reviewed this and said we'll live within our means, but, you know, when you get communication like this, I think people are trying to be part of the team. But understanding that a third of our population participate in this program, and we've got six of our folks trying to make it work, and when you talk to them, they're really, really stressed. If there's a way to increase that, and understanding of Speaker Ben is going through this conversation about how they're really using the strategies to save money and to lower our monies, maybe there might be a way to compensate or pay them back for trying to live within the means.
Yeah, and what should help also, Senator, is just last year again, the Appropriation Act reduced our request by approximately $3.6 million. So this increase here that we're providing for public health is really pretty much bringing up to the same level of our previous request.
Is saying that while his positions are there, they're all unfunded. Mm-hmm. And even as he tries to get them funded, and I know it's another arm, I know it's DOA, right? I understand all of that. But if we all were able to say that these folks need help, it would help.
If I may add, you know, unfortunately, Senator, MIP, Medicaid, food stamps are one of those programs up at Public Health that have a very high turnover rate. The stress factor up there is enormous. We recognize it by the number of GG1s that come through our office for either resignations and or transfers. We are very sympathetic to Public Health, especially in these three particular programs. We understand the need. We understand your concern where you only have seven people handling a $43,000 population program. But when they submit their GG1s into us, understand from public health, it's very difficult to get the applicants to apply. And if they do apply, their tenure is very short because we get the same DG1s with the same position numbers being vacated and then be requested again for recruitment.
I understand that, and I would suggest that job retention is really related to work environment, and that work environment is impacted by, you know, what we're expecting these people to churn out. And this is a third of our population, and yes, we want to get these people to learn how to fish rather than giving them the fish, but right now that's our scenario. And so I just ask that we relook that, and you know, we've got people reaching out, but I do understand the high turnover, and I do suggest that there's reason for high turnover. Thank you. Thank you, Speaker.
Okay. Thank you very much. The MIP appropriation, do you anticipate any change in this given the new PACA Act in terms of accessing this program? This is our local program. Are there anything that would occur under PACA that allows us to shift people from our local program to the federally matched program because of the increase in the poverty level from 125% to 133%, or I'm not sure what the current percentage is now, but that it will increase, the eligibility will increase in terms of household income. And are they making changes in their resource calculation? I think they might be taking out real estate or taking out homes or something to that nature that may cause us to reduce a portion of this?
This is where we rely heavily and we're dependent on the department's input in these areas. We have not been told of any potential changes as a result of maybe new legislation or health policies coming down the line. We hope that public health will provide us this type of information so we can make the proper adjustments as we go forward. But as of today, we have not been told.
Yeah, you haven't.
Along those lines, and then recognizing you actually everybody's is waiting to see as to, you know, the start date and whatnot and eligibility, is there going to be, or do you suggest, a mechanism that would be able to allow us to move the monies over to be able, you know, from the individuals that are probably under MIP into Medicaid, or probably from their insurance plans into Medicaid, to be able to access those federal dollars to make it available to them? I just don't want us to get caught up in somewhere down the middle of a fiscal year where, you know, now these individuals have the opportunity to make that transfer over, or we can move people over from MIP into Medicaid, but we just don't have the money to be able to back that up.
As you mentioned, I think one of the priorities of what public health is doing right now is trying to move all those eligible participants out of the MIP program into Medicaid, and therefore freeing up some of the MIP money. But there is, a provision that allows us to identify additional local match funding in the event that federal dollars do become available.
Okay.
So, federal dollars, should the MIP Medicaid grant awards level rise, then we have a mechanism basically to identify the corresponding local match for those federal dollars.
How much do we have right now putting away from Medicaid
match? I believe the appropriation is about $13 million. It's $13 million for 2012. plus four, the additional. My understanding, though, and I was talking to the speaker yesterday, is that there is a possibility that one may even receive up to $16 million in the future. Mm-hmm. And that's going to be a task, I guess, for us locally to figure out where we're going to get the local match for that additional dollars.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Reyes. We proceed. Mental health,
okay, under
all of this, the consent decree requirements are included in this budget. I know we had money under the federal management team. They're not a receiver, they're a management team. I don't know what's the difference, but one's more polite, I guess. Is there funding still in the original deposits of that money that is not being absorbed in here, or is it fully transitioned into this budget?
Under the miscellaneous provisions of appropriation, there's approximately $1.5 million
okay.
for the next deposit requirement.
Next.
Okay. And that's in addition to what's already been deposited into the account.
Yeah. So the consent decree set up a deposit schedule. Is that the only amount required for fiscal year 2013, or is that the first deposit only?
We're following a payment schedule of what we're supposed to put in place there.
Right.
And I believe it may have been amended to the court action, but right now we're looking at just $1.5 million.
Okay.
Under miscellaneous provisions for the permanent injunction.
Yes, and again, I asked the question, in that payment schedule, is that the only payment required in FY 2013?
I believe so.
Okay.
Just a correction, the amount is, it's 1.25.
1.25, okay.
Yeah, not 1.5.
All right. There's been a transition, I guess, that I see that we see with regards to the residential programs, the residential, and we understand that there's been a shift in from contracting out to bringing them in house. That's factored in here. Was that factored in here, Mr. Reyes?
We just followed the next level of funding that was required on a year-to-year basis that was available for that fund. And that was basically 1.2 million dollars.
1.2.
Okay. Yes, there has been a shift, but the funding for for the residential treatment has been at that same level.
Okay. We're not bringing any new kids back. Island?
That I would have to find out, but I know that we're doing a lot of residential housing mm-hmm. As part of it,
yes.
Which requires personnel.
Right. And that's being funded out of permanent injunction?
That's being funded out of the residential treatment fund.
Okay, that's what I thought. Senator Mabini.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just a quick question on the mental health budget. I understand that hazardous pay was taken away from current year budget, at least towards the end of the fiscal year. I'm wondering, is this included in the 2013 request, a percentage for hazardous pay?
I
Senator, what we have in our budget request comparison is that they actually budgeted for it. Whether or not they're paying it out, we don't know. But they've actually budgeted for it in 2013.
All right, thank you.
That's for the psychiatric text, right?
Yes.
All right. So we'll just have to follow up with the department. Okay. Any other questions on the health side? Yes, Senator Duenas.
Yeah. So, John, I'm not seeing on the mental health there. Are you tracking the fund that was as part of the injunction? So we were made to understand that there was several million dollars in there. I don't see it anywhere in the special funds, or is that just purely administered by the receiver?
The funds you're referring to was our deposits into a third party.
Right.
Okay. The only way we're tracking that is through the appropriations that we have for that account.
Okay.
And revenue, DOA and I believe it's working together with mental health to continually update it. But that's not a special fund at all. It's considered part of the
receivership.
Okay. We have no control over that.
Okay, well, I understand that. I just think it's really, in order, just for the oversight purpose in terms of service delivery, maybe we can request it then directly from them, just because, you know, we get consistent updates sometimes about the service delivery. And so you obviously have reflected in your budget an increase of about 25%, and that would be on top of what they probably are managing in their account now.
25% of the mental health budget?
Right.
No, the mental health budget is based on what they what we develop based on the ceiling. Any increase to the permanent injunction is through the miscellaneous appropriation of 1.25.
Okay, so this is just the administration's request of an increase exclusive of that?
Yes.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Chair. Thanks, John.
And John, they file an expenditure report and they're reporting to the judge, correct?
Yes. They do provide us information on what they spend. And
right.
But yeah, after a while, it's...
Yeah. Now, is DOE processing their payments, DOA?
DOA.
Or is it all through the courts and do they control that checking account?
My understanding is basically it's like a grant. We pay, it's basically primarily for personnel services.
Right.
But then we request a reimbursement for what we spent for a period of time.
So is this $2 million at mental health a reimbursement for some positions that were picked up by mental health to satisfy the service requirements under the permanent injunction?
When we did the budget for mental health, we had to consider the plan. The plan basically says is that if we bring in a person under FMT,
right,
1 year from their employment, they come back to us.
Right.
And so we try to adjust for those numbers that are being reimbursed or being paid, will be coming back to us for which the general fund has to pay for it. So that's some of those things.
Some of that is in here.
Right.
Because I think, if I'm not mistaken, that FMT has hired maybe 60 people, somewhere around there? Right.
There is a listing on the mental health budget that shows the number of people being hired, but we still have to make allowances for them per the requirements of the permanent injunction.
Yeah, we have to pick them up and integrate them into the mental health regular staff.
Yes.
Right. Okay. Right. Serious?
Under education, which includes Department of Education, the University of Guam, Guam Community College, the request for increase is 0.27 total. For the general fund, the request was 1.21% of 2012's appropriation. And under this category, education, I believe it represents close to around 34% of the total budget.
Okay. Speak on that.
On maintenance and insurance for the Teton campus. So, is this being reflected, of course, under the Department of Education's budget then, that even though you've listed it separately, is that it is, you're making it as if though it is a part of the education's budget rather than the obligation of the government? That it's not a part of this budget? Because you clumped it, of course, under education, and you've listed that under, of course, education, saying that 34% of, you know, the entire budget then comes, goes to education. I mean, the trend that we're seeing here now is that everything aside from operations of the department is that the department has to incur all of the additional cost now as compared to what we normally have done, is that if you look at all of our debt obligations, you know, of course, we carve that out all separately before then we consider what we're going to give the different departments. In this case, we're seeing that the Department of Education is having to, they're being burdened now with actually having now to, out of their total budget, is to then use it not just for insurance and maintenance, but even the, you know, expansion of the schools or building of new schools, or even for their repairs and everything now, is becoming now a part of the department's budget. And I say this, of course, because if you really look at the budget of the Department of Education in particular, that there's very little left for supplies, materials, textbooks, you know, what we consider critical supplies and equipment for teaching and learning. But yet we're, you know, of course, we're maintaining for, naturally, yes, utilities, vendor payments, you know, personnel. And no considerations being given here for the other needed supplies and materials.
Okay, yeah, and Senator, first, with the maintenance and insurance, I'm sorry, but we'll still need to clarify that, and I feel that it is part of the JFK. Clarify that, and we'll get back to you on that.
And the other thing also is because our understanding is that this would be shouldered by the vendor, the owner of the property, unless we've made a commitment to purchase it. So right now it's a lease, and if it's a lease, this is normally built into the lease. That's our understanding, and I hope that you'll be able to clarify that, you know, and get back to us.
Yeah, I was looking at the long-term debt abstract from GEDA, and it looks for 2013, it was about $6.6 million for JFK. And right now in the debt service, we're showing 5.1. So with that 5.1 and this 1.5, that's how I'm looking. I'm thinking that's part of the JFK. So we'll clarify that again. With regards to the Department of Education's budget, yes, you know, right now they show about, I think with DOE, it's around 26% of the total budget. If you look at the state expenditure report for average states, it's been decreasing over time from 2009, 10, and 11. In fact, in 2011, the average was around 20-21% of the total expenditures for state budget. So we're still, you know, we're a little more, but, you know, we do know that we have problems here in the Department of Education, and that's why there's a lot more for DOE.
But, you know, you can't just do that kind of comparison because the organization of DOE is really very different from the states, because and one major thing, of course, that you would see that would definitely, where you are looking to increase the number of per pupil costs will be the additional personnel in terms of providing supervision, you know, for students. We're in the mainland, that of course is being done by the teachers. So to do that kind of comparison, to say that if the states are coming down, why is it that, you know, we're going up? There's a that is a major difference in those two systems.
And also, you know, just to add on to that, our analyst has been meeting with DOE and discussing their existing 2012 projections to the end of the year. And it doesn't look like there's going to be some lapses that will take care of some of the prior obligations that they've had, some of their vendor payments. We still need to sit down. I've asked them to sit down with Tolling again sometime next week. We'll go into detail and we'll see how much of that prior year vendor payments that we can take care of the end of the year, because that will only help us, because it will reduce the deficit again, because part of the deficit is, of course, DOE's past due payments.
Yeah, according to the report that we're getting from the EFSC, is that the lapse would come from the $2 million appropriation for textbooks. So, you know, that lapsed, but we're not buying textbooks. So, you know, we're foregoing textbooks to create a lapse, to pay something else, but we've got to buy textbooks. The other lapse would come from not paying increments, because it's budgeted. But we're going to take the money that was budgeted for increments, pay something else, and then we're going to owe the increments. So we're changing one liability from owing somebody else by paying some prior year debt with that increment appropriation, which lapsed because it wasn't implemented, but we still owe increments at the end of the fiscal year, because that's the way the increment, you know, that obligation works. It's an earned right of the employee. And if you don't pay it, you owe it. So it's not going to reduce our deficit. It's just going to trade our, you know, like the governor said, we'll owe the bondholders instead of the taxpayers. Well, we'll owe the employees instead of you know, somebody else, because we took the money that we budgeted for the employees for their increments, and we're taking it and paying somebody else. You know, I would rather that was budgeted for, that's accounted for, that should be paid, and we should find a resource in other areas from other savings to pay that other vendor. Why do we want to take the money from the employee and pay somebody else and owe the employee? I mean, that was the whole issue and push by the governor to go borrow the money to pay the refunds, because we didn't want to owe the taxpayer. You know, so again, I encourage to look at that policy call of not paying the increments, because we don't have the money, but we're going to take the money we budgeted for increments to pay somebody else. Yeah. It doesn't make sense.
Yeah. And I'm not defending Department of Education's budget. I know that they submitted their budget directly to you,
right,
and discussed it with you. But, you know, that is something that they're looking at. And, you know, I'm sure that they know that you feel otherwise, that you'd rather not you'd rather find other funds to pay for vendor payments than to pay the increments.
No, but
that's what you're saying, finding savings elsewhere to pay for the...
But they're not able to pay that increment because you froze it, or the governor froze it. It's not on their own decision. They didn't decide to freeze it themselves. They're not creating that lapse by saying, let's not pay increments. It was based on the executive order that told DOE, you will not pay increments. That's why I'm asking you to re-examine that policy call of freezing the increments so you can create lapses to pay somebody else, when that increment is budgeted for, accounted for, collected, and why do we want to switch the liability from, you know, that liability that we owe? You know, we owe Bill an increment, but we owe Jane money, so we're going to take Bill's increment and say, oh, we're saving this money by not paying Bill his increment, but we're going to pay Jane her bill. But we still owe Bill. So why not just pay Bill and we'll find other resource that was not dedicated to find and pay Jane. And so that's why I'm asking to, if the issue is we want to freeze the increments because we want to reduce our deficit, we're not reducing that deficit because that increment that goes unpaid gets added to the deficit. That's all I'm saying. So again, I'm just requesting that perhaps you might, based upon our discussion today and our perspective that we're offering you, discuss that issue with the governor on the matter of the increments. Because we're not talking about a huge sum of money. We're talking about maybe $3 million, you know, for the increments. So why do we want to take $3 million from the employees' pockets and pay another bill and then say, I owe you? Because we do owe them. It's not like that liability gets wiped out just because we froze it. So, and it is because of that fact. You know, there are some bills, like you say, when we freeze, that the liability, it doesn't accrue. But in this case, it accrues. And so maybe we just need to reexamine that policy.
And so for DOE's case, you did mention that there is an attorney general opinion that's saying that that incentive is due to the employees, right?
For the entire executive branch. Yeah. For the entire executive branch, not just DOE. And by the way, again, based on the budget that was released to the semi-autonomous agencies, they've processed those increments and paid them out this fiscal year because it was budgeted. It was only the executive branch in which the governor says, you know, I'm going to save this money, but it's not really saving it because that liability will accrue. So I just want to kind of re-examine that.
Okay. Can we get a copy also of the
sure.
attorney? Okay, thank
sure.
you.
Maybe if I can just explain one thing as well, too, so that maybe you can have also a better understanding of the situation for the textbooks, because we know that there's a reduction, of course, in revenues, and one of the measures taken with the department, of course, was that we've extended now the adoption from what they normally would do every, you know, 5 years to now every 7 years to, you know, and do their part as well in terms of the less monies that they're getting. They used to be able to get like $3.5 million. It's been reduced now to even $2 million. And yet, of course, there is this law, the adequate education that every child is entitled to, that they all must have textbooks, and many of our students still do not have textbooks. And even by the time that if you don't provide the monies or release the monies for them to order the textbooks, then by the time, of course, whatever they've adopted, already then, whenever we decide to give it, already it just makes the textbook much older, and then the books are only going to be able to stay on the books as an adopted textbook for maybe only 2 years before they have to start again to adopt a new series. So those are really, you know, important things to have an understanding of, and why it's important that, you know, you release the monies for the textbooks for the schools. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other questions? Okay.
One more on education. And, you know, of course, this is, I mean, we talk about this all the time, and there's in the books as well of incentives being given to departments and agencies when they try to save the government, you know, millions of dollars or hundreds and thousands of dollars. And here we have an institution, the Guam Community College, you really save the government millions of dollars in terms of infrastructure. And yet, of course, we get a department, I mean, an institution such as this, who would get a reduction in, you know, in their budget when they've gone far and beyond, of course, you know, in terms of saving the government money and, you know, being recognized, of course, for that, in terms of excellence and their accreditation. So I'm just, you know, we really need to start shifting our thinking here too, as well, is to you know, reward, you know, because you've just done that recently, of course, with public health, with individuals where you've given merit pays, you know, for some savings that they did. And here's an institution that's done the exact same thing, but far, you know, exceeding, I mean, we're talking millions, like, over $20 million, and yet, you know, we reduce their budget.
We Well, you know, actually, Senator, the reduction in GCC basically is only in the federal funds. They've actually got a slight increase in the general fund, but if you look on the sheet, it's only on the federal side that they receive the reduction. So that's where the negative percentage comes in. But at the local funds, we actually did support them by giving them more. A little bit more, but it's
I mean,
more.
I know when you look at it and you're just looking numbers to last year's and this year's, and you're saying, okay, yeah, we're giving them a $2,000 increase, but in essence, in terms of their mission,
Understood. I appreciate it. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Reyes, proceed.
Okay, under the finance and administration, which includes Department of Administration, Government's Claim Fund, the annual single audit, there was a decrease in the general fund about 1.69%. The total, including the special fund, was approximately 1.15% increase.
The increase in the special fund, is that indirect costs?
Okay. Yes.
That's good. And we're sure we're going to get the glitches that may be in there, which shows the tracking to be below the proposed number here. That will ensure that they will receive this funding for their operations?
95% sure.
95% sure. If you fund them 100% from indirect, maybe they'll, you know, we tried that, John. We put in the budget bill that if they don't put in the convenience fees, their budget gets reduced, but it just didn't work. We still don't have the entire system and program put in place for the financial management there. So I hope you have a bigger stick than we do on this one. So. And land management?
Under natural resources, we're looking at a general fund decrease of about 2.11% from the 2012 Appropriation Act. Total decrease, including special fund and federal match, is approximately 2.5%, which is about $300,000 decrease.
John, I'm kind of curious on that Chamorro Land Trust. So you're taking the 735 and for Chamorro Land Trust and decreasing their entire budget, basically. And where are you putting that money? Right. But again, you know, I don't believe trust as it was established and the use of the proceeds of the trust can be used for other purposes. My understanding and my policy, I guess, or philosophy on this is that it should be dedicated to the trust and we should separate that out. And so this integration of the resource into land management to be placed under the control of land management, in my opinion, is totally improper and contrary to the trust and the establishment of that trust. So, you know, I don't think this is proper.
Senator, what it is that through the governor's reorganization, we they combined the Department of Land Management, Ancestral Lands, and Chamorro Land Trust. Although the appropriation is under land management, it's still held in a separate account in the trust fund. It's just organizational-wise, it's under Department of Land Management. But those monies are kept separate and apart from the general operation and appropriation of land management.
So why is it necessary to integrate?
Only because of the reorg puts Chamorro Land Trust under land management.
But it still has its own board?
I believe those are some of the kinks that we're still trying to work out, even in positions. I do believe that the administrator for initially those positions were supposed to be phased out. So I believe the request is with Department of Administration, HR, to see what they can do to realign those position titles to make it more in line with the reorg.
But that has to be approved by the board. I mean, the governor can't reorganize that without the consent of the board.
And I'm sure there's already conversations being done on that level.
Right, but here we're kind of stepping ahead of that, ahead of the conclusion of those discussions. So
I think in this presentation, Senator, it was just for planning purposes that this was done. If it doesn't hold true and it's contrary to law, I'm sure that we'll probably go back. But right now, just for planning purposes, and because the reorg, we presented the budget this way.
Okay. So I think we can plan on undoing this and separating out the appropriation so that it's clearly, you know, it's clear with regards to the current legislation of establishing the trust and not commingling trust assets with others that may divert the beneficial use of trust assets to non-beneficiaries. You know, would be averted and avoided. So that would be the approach that I think we would take at this time.
Understood.
Until we fully complete all
yes.
of the outstanding issues, as you say,
yes.
and conclude those discussions.
Okay.
Senator, Speaker Wampat.
Thank you very much. You know, I understand what you've done in the reorganization, but then at the same time, and I have to agree, of course, with that. You know, the chairman here is that, and the way we do this with our other departments and agencies where they have personnel, you know, who are funded locally and personnel who are funded federally as well, that when you finalize this, of course, because I heard you just say that you're looking at position as well, similar position titles and all that and what they're doing, but, you know, until such time that that is being done, I hope you're treating this, yes, as a division, so to speak, of the Chamorro Land Trust and the personnel that are there, and that the funds in the trust are used specifically, you know, for that purpose. And it is the policy of, you know, this legislature through the mandates that says that, you know, those monies are to be used specifically for, you know, Chamorro Land Trust. You know, personnel and you know, and other functions, not for land management. So, please make sure that you know you do not use those monies to support the other operations, just of land management. Although I do know that they are using their surveyors sometimes to help with the Chamorro Land Trust, and you know, whatever that you know, of course, the percentage of the work being done for Chamorro Land Trust, then you know, I can appreciate, of course, the fact that there would be a need to apportion maybe to pay for that, but surely, at least for the time being, until you answer all those questions, it'll be safest to just continue to stay within, you know, the law that created the trust fund.
Thank you, Speaker Ben. And so let me continue the whole thought with reorganization. I want to talk about Department of Agriculture. And I don't know if you'd be able to pointedly answer or address my concerns. And while I respect the governor's authority by the Organic Act to reorganize, I do believe, and I've talked to Civil Service about that there are still steps that need to be taken when you are shuffling, when you are creating, when you are eliminating or classified folks. They are protected. And so I'm really concerned that there are names that are no longer listed in the functional sheets or functional organization charts proffered by the Department of Agriculture. Somehow people are just disappearing, and I do not believe that's correct. I think it's very disrespectful, as a matter of fact. And so I'm wondering, Mr. Rios, would you be able to answer to the reorganization efforts of Department of Agriculture?
Can we go ahead and provide the details? Do we have the details of it?
Because I don't want to want to, you know, discuss it if you really aren't able to. I mean, I don't want to, you know, make this your issue if it is not your issue. And if indeed, you know, maybe agriculture people need to come in. I don't know. I mean, I was speaking to staff and they were saying maybe.
Yeah, what we sent a letter. I don't know if you've gotten it. We reserve today and tomorrow. Tomorrow we also have reserved public hearing. And we've asked Mr. Rios to, that if he needs to bring in, if he wishes to bring in any directors, you know, if we decide to continue through tomorrow, and he wishes to bring in any directors, then he's free to do so for tomorrow.
And so, you know, with that being said, let me just state that we've taken divisions, turned them into two. We've taken certain folks and put them under the director's office. There's law enforcement that is now going to be under the director's office. And so, but what really, and I'm not questioning, you know, what's best. First of all, let me state, I think natural resources are really important to our island. I just really believe it needs to be further developed. But perhaps more important than that, I really think regard for the people needs to be upheld. And when I talk and I speak with these people, they are not included in this decision-making process. Director Rios, they are telling me that they got a phone call saying, did you know your budget was forwarded and that this is what it's going to look like? And so there was no discourse. They've taken it to their director, and there's lots of perhaps, I think they're trying to toe the line, be a team player. But when you're talking about people's lives, and their people and their work life and their personal life, there's just a way to reorg, and they're not engaged in the conversations. Decisions were made on faulty data. Data was forwarded saying that the animal control people don't do anything and they collect this and that. And so the response to all of those data sets have been turned over, have been referred. So some kind of back and forth is going, but I'm really concerned that the people are not being respected in the decisions that are being rendered. I have forwarded my concerns, so this is not new, okay? But now we're talking about budget. And I'm concerned that we're trying to reorganize through the budget. And again, I understand the governor of Guam, through the Organic Act, can offer reorganization, that he shall. But I also suggest that we've got public law that says that our classified employees are protected. And there's just a way to deal with that. And it's not being done properly. So that is my biggest concern about agriculture. And when I see that the cost savings for agriculture is going to be around 6%, I really wonder where the cost analysis is. I'm wondering what kind of data was done. I talked to the employees. They were never spoken with. Their data that is forwarded to the front office is flawed. And honestly, you know, as people say, I've been on this education reform, and people are saying that there's a atmosphere of fear at DOE, I will suggest there's an atmosphere of fear at the Department of Agriculture. And we're talking about budget. I won't support reorganization through budget. I think the processes need to be carried through. I just do. And the same statement, I don't know if we've gotten to it or not, the same statement will go towards the public libraries being under that one, Shawa Affairs, President Cameron. There's a way to do it. Right, there's just a way to do it. And so in the end, it could be that's the best for our island, in the end. But we haven't gone through those processes. And so I don't know if you could speak to data, cost analysis, what's going to ensure that we realize our mission for natural resources and how this all comes together, or if you would like to bring in Director Tidegui and Deputy Director Cruz. I understand Deputy Cruz is the one who actually crafted the reorganization in Advisory Number 8. Which was signed by Lieutenant Governor Ray Tenorio in an acting capacity. And so I have all of these documents, and I'm just saying right now, that part of this budget, as far as agriculture goes, I have very great concern about, and I just cannot support. Thank you very much, Speaker Ben.
Thank you very much, Senator Yamashita. I just want to recognize Senator Tom Atta, and thank him for also joining us this morning. Senator Frank Moss.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Mr. Rios, I'm going to have to echo the sentiments and concerns brought on by Senator Yamashita with regards to this. You know, I appreciate and applaud with regards to the efforts to be able to reduce the budget. But what are we, you know, based on, again, the concerns and the, that have been brought to our offices, not just by the employees, but also by the consumers, on you know, what is actually been has been proposed to be reduced. I think we're taking a step back with regards to many of our other efforts in other areas in economic development, economic growth, more specifically in the area of aquaculture and agriculture. And so I'm also interested in as far as the data as to how we got to this. But, you know, along those lines, and I want to go just to the one right below it with regards to gain. And I recognize and I see that there is no decrease in as far as their budget. But the same token, I have to recognize, too, let's recognize that GAIN primarily is a nonprofit organization. Have we gotten in as far as their financials and as far as other than the monies they receive from the government, what efforts they have and how much money they have to be able to put into, I mean, from their end, from their side, their share of running the operations? Do we have that information?
I believe they're supposed to report it to Department of Administration.
Okay. And so I'm very much interested to see that too, you know.
And you know, with regards to agriculture, I will sit down with the director regarding your concern. Just looking at 2012 request that we submitted, the Appropriation Act for 2012 reduced the general fund budget by $166,000 last year. So it is a concern, and let me go ahead and I'll sit down with Director Tidyman.
But then also with regards to the information, you know, on the financial activity of GAIN.
On GAIN? Okay. I'll check with Department of Administration.
Please? Okay. And then I too, am interested with regards to the data and the information as far as 7% reduction. It's great, but what are we, what now have we cut? Are we cutting off our nose despite our face? You know, and as far as, you know, one of the concerns and the issues that were brought to me was there was a reduction in as far as the workforce and as far as the services that can be provided to farmers. When on the other end, we're trying to grow an industry here to be able not only to be self-sustaining, but to for economic advantage, opportunities and stuff. And so I just don't want this reduction here to be the impetus for failure of, you know, economic opportunities on the other side. Okay?
Thank you very much, Senator
Tyler. Just to jump in on that, could it be the decrease there? Could that have been the increase that was given to the additional appropriation given to the mayors for animal control? Because it's about the same. It's 173.
That is correct, Senator. The based on the reorg, what it did is that it just shifted the animal control division of the Department of Agriculture to the control of the mayors. We took the corresponding funding for those positions and gave it over to the mayors. So that is the corresponding deduction and increase between the two agencies.
Except that the four animal control people didn't go to mayors. They went under the director.
Right.
Yeah, and so I don't see where the reduction is there.
Again, for presentation purposes, for planning purposes, it was done this way. Hopefully, come October 1st, that shift will be done, because the intent is to move those animal control personnel over to the mayors.
And when we do that kind of shifting again, I offer that you have to work with them.
Yes.
Right? And it really can't be through a piece of paper. They're talking about men who have worked really hard to do what they can to keep our streets safe.
Any further questions? Senator, we're almost there. Mr. Reyes, where did the energy office go? I'm just curious. I know that we didn't, I'm just kind of curious where is it under, where's the funding under now?
100%
federal.
Yeah.
Department used to receive some general fund appropriations,
right,
a couple of years ago, but since then they've become
serious. Or, yes, Senator Adams? Yes, that's fine. That's we're part of the natural resources.
All right. Maybe if you could explain the rationale for the 10% reduction in the Parks and Rec, especially at a time when, you know, we're concerned about the health in this community, and of course, Parks and Rec, I believe, plays a very critical role in the preventative aspects. And so, what is being sacrificed here with this 10% reduction?
Basically, the reduction is because of their prior advance funding under Parks and Recs. They've never really spent their appropriated amount. Yes. Yeah.
Senator Adda, any follow-up?
No.
Senator Adda?
Would Parks and Rec then... How is it that they maintain the public cemetery or provide for additional burial spaces, and did they put that anywhere in their budget for the construction of additional crypts? Or
I believe that's under miscellaneous appropriation, and I believe that they have yet to put in a request, or they may have put in a request, but money may not be available at the time they put it in. But that's something that they have to look at and let us know. But if they're yeah, we don't have authorization to move money into the miscellaneous, then it becomes lapsed.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you very much, Senator. Any additional comments? Mr. Rios, Mr. Guerrero? On those questions. Okay. Labor?
Okay, under... Department of Labor, Workers' Comp, Professional Engineers, Contractors License Board. The request is to reduce the appropriation by 6.47% compared to 2012 levels. The total, including special funds and federal fund matching, would reduce the request by 4.97%, or about 182,000.
The decrease in the Department of Labor's budget, John, you know, with the current unemployment rate and the services that they're supposed to be providing to assist the unemployed in finding employment, is that kind of contrary to the needs of the community and the war on poverty?
Basically, again, the Department of Labor in the past have not been using all their lapse funding. Mm-hmm. So we look at what they needed, look at our ceilings, and then we made the appropriate adjustments.
Okay. Senator Labini?
Yes. Maybe I don't know whether I'm missing it here in the sheet, but wasn't there an executive order that separated Department of Labor and HRD? And shouldn't they then be appearing here on a separate line then?
HRD is 100% federal again. They're not represented.
Okay. Like WAM Energy office,
yes,
is appearing
correct
here, but without a budget. So, you know, it probably should be there only just so we, you know, we understand.
Yes,
it is,
yeah,
it is an operation.
Okay. For presentation purposes, yes.
I have a question.
Yes, Senator?
You know, this is the second agency in a row that you've indicated that the reason why the reduction is because in the previous year, they have not expended all their appropriations, suggesting that they probably didn't need all that was appropriated in the previous year. But we also know that maybe those lapses occur because although I know that in the case, for example, of Department of Labor, they have a position
for an inspector under the OSHA division that they have not been able to fill. And we know how it works. I mean, the department can initiate the GG1, and it gets stuck in BBMR because there's no, you know, they don't fund it. So as a result, at the end of the year, they have all this lapses in their budget. So I'm just a little concerned that you know, the justification being used is because they were appropriated, you know, $10,000 last year and they only used $8,000. So therefore, maybe the only they need what they need this year is just $8,000.
Again, it's based on the ceiling that's been provided by the Department of Labor, and it's based on warm bodies or bodies of field position as well as any approved vacancies up to January. And based on that, they develop the budgets with the ceilings that we give them. It's up to the appointing authority to make the call on what the GG wants to be processed. And if they do it early in time for the budget process, then we would consider it. But if it's after the budget process, then we're looking only at approved vacancies that we did based on fulfilling a position that was once vacant. So it's the planning stages as well.
All right. Senator, just for your information, we requested from the Bureau of Budget a current expenditure rate and then projecting out to the end of the fiscal year for all the line item categories. So they're putting that information together in that format, and will give that to us by next week, and we'll make that available to all the senators so that we can see where they're lapsing. Either they're lapsing in contracts or they're lapsing in personnel, which, you know, comes to the issue of, yeah, I can't, it's not that I don't want to fill it, it's I can't fill it, or you know, and so we'll be able to then drill a little further after that with that information, so.
Yeah, we received the Excel, the template last night, and so we have our staff working on those details to provide to the committee.
Yeah, okay. There was some discussion in one of the audits, John, with regards to the Professional Engineers, Architects, and Land Surveyors Fund, with regards to, I guess, a fund that was not reflected in the, was it in the appropriation, or that fund that they had, that, yeah, side checking account, has that been integrated now with the budget in and reflected in here? I think it was noted in one of the audits, correct?
I'm sorry, I haven't seen the audit.
Senator Addis,
2011.
I think what it was that the appeals board had actually created a side check-in account, and so as fees were coming in, some of those fees were deposited in the general fund, and some were deposited in this other check-in account. But what they reported as revenues that came in was just what was deposited. At any rate, in following up with this, that check-in account, the side check-in account, has in fact been closed.
Okay.
And so it's just a matter of, you know, really keeping on top of it.
Okay.
Basically, when we get the revenues from the AS-400,
mm-hmm.
and whatever is there in terms of revenue projection is what we use. So if they did move that into the, it would be probably just cash, depending on how they book the, mm-hmm. the cash receipts as a revenue for the year or the prior year.
Okay.
Sure.
Yes.
John, I noticed you've, you know, there's been some reorganizations that have taken place, and I suggest that you really take a look at the Contractors License Board. Earlier this year, we conducted an information briefing, and here's an entity that, of course, it was created about 20-some years ago, and it raises revenues from the licenses that it issues. Now, they have, for example, 5 inspectors there. and inquiring as to what do these inspectors look for. They said, well, we have an inspector that goes out and looks for safety violations out in the job sites. To find out later that Department of Labor also has a position for a safety inspector, but have not been able to fill that. They have four other inspectors who go out to the job site, and supposedly these guys read the blueprints and they go out there to determine if the contractor is building according to the blueprints. So they say. But then you go to Department of Public Works, Building and Permits, and the inspection section, and these guys are, you know, trying to cover the entire island with three inspectors, maybe. And so this is something where probably really needs to be looked at, that maybe those inspectors and the funding that comes for them really should come under a Department of Public Works to do those construction inspections. Now, in this particular board also, there's, I believe, three or four administrator people. And the bulk of their work comes in this 30-day window during the month, wherein the contractors are required to go to the different agencies and get sign-offs that, yes, you've been a good contractor and all that. And then they give it to them, and then they type out the license. And in my mind, I'm just thinking that maybe this is really a function, and the funding that goes with it should probably come under the Department of Public Works. This is something that needs to be looked at closely, because it seems like there's a lot of duplication of effort here. And this is just, I think, something that you need to take a look at. And I bring this up in the context of, as we look at the next page, Department of Public Works is going to, is only getting a 0.37% increase from what it got last year. And we know right there that's not even going to be, that increase is not even going to be enough to offset the added maintenance cost for the old bus fleet that they have, much less everything else. So I bring up the Contractors License Board in that context and ask that you take a close look at that. Thank you.
Senator Rios?
Well, yes, and you know, Mesa. You say Senator Rios.
I'm just checking to see if you're paying attention. I don't think you are.
No, I've seen a lot of improvement in the Contractors License Board, especially in issuing the license itself. And now you don't have to wait a week or 2 weeks. They just, boom, print it out and give it to you there. And so, reorganization, I guess, is what, you know, the recommendation is, and maybe something that we can look at. As for Public Works, I guess we'll wait until we get to that section and discuss a little bit about Public Works.
All right. Then you may continue, sir. Tourism and Culture.
Okay, under Tourism and Culture, the request, again, is a little less than a percent decrease from the 2012 Appropriation Act. Or approximately $25,000 in general fund. The overall decrease in tourism, when including special fund and federal matches, less than or 50 basis points, or about $18,000. This tourism and culture includes the Chamorro Fairs, Guam Council and Arts, Humanities, PBS, Guam Public Library, Advances, and the Guam Territorial Band Society.
So by reorganizing, we went from a budget of $960,000 to $3.1 million?
That's correct. Just the shifting of funds. But yeah, the impact on this is really, is pretty nominal.
Mr. Chair?
Yes.
So then we didn't realize a huge savings in closing the libraries? I mean, I'm only looking at a savings of $17,000, and we closed 3-4 libraries.
Yeah, it's all part of Chamorro Parish. When the Guam, you're talking about the Guam Public Library, right?
Yes,
right. Now, just that there shows a 100% decrease because everything, part of the reorganization, transfers it up to the Chamorro Parish.
Yeah, but when we only had the Guam Public Libraries, we had 5 libraries open with that budget of 1.3, and we close 4 libraries. And we don't see a savings here.
Senator, and if I may, just like the Chamorro Land Trust and the ancestral lands being consolidated into land management, we're still going through the process actually of identifying the positions that in the end, in the long run, that may be deleted, may be terminated. We are looking at areas within the reorganization to better consolidate once the reorg actually takes full effect.
But Steve, it has taken effect because you've...
The consolidation, yes, Senator. I agree with you. Consolidating the agencies, yes, we've done that. But there's, like you said, there's processes that we need to go through, which involves the HR part, which involves basically... deleting the overlapping or duplicating of efforts, consolidating positions. Instead of having 3, all we may need is just 1. Those kind of things are still in the process of being done.
I know, but again,
so therefore the savings, the true savings, won't be realized until that's actually completed.
But why wasn't that done first? You know, why wasn't the legwork, the grunt work, the process done, and when you complete that process, then you consolidate and then you save money? But this is probably going to be your biggest reconsolidation or reorganization in terms of moving parts, because you got 5 or 6 moving parts. And even just that, Steve, as Senator Tony Atta pointed out, we closed the village libraries, and we're finding that we're not even seeing a single penny reduction in the closing of the village libraries and giving access to our children for those books in Agat, in Bargata, in Maleso, in Dedido, in Jonya. I mean, we closed all of those libraries, yet, even if it hasn't begun, you haven't finished the process, we're not even seeing... Where's the power reduction at least? Because now they don't fall under the library budget.
Understood. Those facilities actually were transferred over to the respective mayors of where the libraries are. But unfortunately, we are still paying for the utility costs of those facilities.
Mr. Chair.
So therefore, we're...
If I can interject in that one, and I appreciate that. And Stephen, we should get Mr. McCameron here, because with regards to even the transfer... the mayor of Barragata is still waiting for the keys.
From what I was told, Senator, those facilities were transferred over to the mayor's office.
Well, that's why.
Are you sure it wasn't just a press release?
And I think, Steve, that in all fairness to you and to John and Bill